welcome everybody to back to Biz Kids. We have a very special guest in today's session, and actually because Evie's got to leave, we've already dived straight in with the Q&A. So we will be having plenty of time to ask Esther questions. So if anyone's new here, you've all just been through the promote to panelist so that you can come into the live lesson and share all your work and join in the interactive discussion. So me and Annie are here each week teaching entrepreneurship, business, financial literacy and mindset to kids. And the lessons are free so that we can reach as many kids as possible. In terms of this term, we've got three lessons remaining this term, and it's every Monday at 4:30 live. And the lesson format goes, we'll share some news and updates. We will then have our special guest, our very special guest, I should say, very with a very big V, who's Esther, who will be sharing her story and wisdom. And then at the end of the lesson, you guys can ask any questions. So in terms of Biz Kids news and updates, we have our pop song on its way out. So this weekend, Annie, Mila and Stella are filming the Goddess music video. Now, I know lots of you have asked when the music video is going to come out. Annie and Stella, how are you feeling about filming the Goddess music video?
Good.
Good. There's quite a complicated dance that's being learned. So we'll share more of it as the Goddess music video progresses. But we're expecting the song to be out in about 3 to 4 weeks' time. We'll be releasing it on TikTok and on Spotify as well. For today's lesson, we have a very special guest, and I'm going to start by asking you guys a few questions. All you're going to need is just something to make notes on if you want to ask any questions to Esther, and make sure you think of any question you've ever wanted to ask to somebody who works in the British government, because now is your chance, okay? She's here. Get your questions ready. Now, remember in Biz Kids, there's absolutely no such thing as a bad idea or a silly question. And just remember to put your hands up so we don't have everybody shouting at once. Just letting Noah in. So before we introduce our guests, I've got some questions for you guys. Who knows what the government is? Who can answer the question, what is the government? William, what's the government?
Government is a party or a group of people who lead a country or in political circumstances.
Great answer, William. Faith, what do you think the government is?
They're like MSPs and different parties of people, like dictatorship and democracy.
Great answer. Esther, how do you answer that? What is the government?
I think they both had cracking answers there. So you're right, we live in a democracy. Every 5 years there's a general election. A party is chosen, the two main parties of this country is the Conservative Party and the Labour Party. Whoever wins forms the government of the day. And then within the 350s or however many a party's got, they will choose the government, the working government. So there are backbenchers and people who are in the government. And those who are in the government, ministers, parliamentary undersecretaries, and then the cabinet, people who are in the cabinet, so the secretaries of state who work with the prime minister. So you can see the structure, how it goes from sort of cabinet the way to backbenchers. But as you say, the winning party forms the government of the day.
And who can answer the question, what's the government minister? Who knows what a government minister is? William?
Isn't a government... Why am I forgetting this? I went to Parliament recently.
Very good.
A government minister, I think, is a head of some kind of like, I want to say like subject, in the sense that like, so as in there's head of finance or like minister of finance or minister of education, or minister of being or something, I don't know.
William, great answer. You've pretty much got it. Let's just see what the others are saying. Evie, what's the government minister?
I think a government minister, if I'm right,
this comes from the term prime minister. I think it's like one of the main people in the government. Not, I don't say that one's more important than another, but maybe one that really stands out to people, that really chooses what they're going to do in life and really makes up the rules and really is a boss. But I feel like none of the government is more important than the prime minister. I feel like they're both equal, but I feel like that one's just more of a higher standard and maybe higher democracy and stuff.
Esther, what do you think about those answers?
I think we've all done very well on that. I think we were getting there from William, that there are various ministers of state, secretaries of state, all running the various departments of government. So you were right, there was education, there's transport, there's the defence. You were talking about the Chancellor and the Treasury. So you've got all these various departments that make up the government that help with running the country. And within those departments, there are ministers of various degrees, like a junior minister, minister of state, and as I said, the secretary of state there. So you did well.
Brilliant. Fantastic. Okay, so everyone, Esther's already here. You've all semi-met her, but let's tell you who Esther is and a bit about her career, and then we'll be handing over to Esther. So everybody say hi to Esther McVeigh, who is a government minister.
Hi.
And she's a cabinet minister and an MP. So Esther is, as you can see there, Esther, what are you doing here? Going into 10 Downing Street?
I was going into 10 Downing Street, and this was on the 13th of November when I was promoted back into, I'd say, government and back into being a cabinet minister. And that was me on the way in. So I hadn't actually been told my job. I was on my way in.
And Esther found out when she went in, she was appointed a cabinet minister without portfolio, and that was in November 2023. Now, before that, Esther has done so many amazing jobs in government and in business as well. So she's been a minister of state for housing, communities and local government. And here she is at a meeting inside Downing Street. Esther, there's a lot of men in that meeting and you're one of a few women. What does that feel like?
To be fair, you shouldn't really think too much about who everybody else is sometimes in the room. You just got to make sure you do a good job in there. And despite me being, as you said, only one in what seems like a sea of men, you can just see there, maybe Theresa May. And whilst there might not have been too many women in there, she was the prime minister. There wasn't too many women, but the women who were in there had the high-flying jobs and a woman had the top job.
Which is fantastic to see. Esther's also been Secretary of State for Work and Pensions. William, you know how you were saying the government operates on topics, which is almost right, divisions of areas of responsibility. And you can see that Esther over the years has worked across work and pensions, household and employment. So in all of those subjects or areas of responsibility, Esther has done a lot of different roles and experience. So Esther, tell us about this, your election to MP for Tatton.
Ah, we talked about that before, when you have a general election and that works out, the party with the most MPs gets to run the country. The manifesto it set out in the general election is how it's going to run the country. You have to win your seat. There's 650 of them, and there I was running for one place called Tatton, which is in Cheshire, and you have to just try and get as many votes as possible. As I said, standing on the ticket of Conservatism, that was me, and you have to lead a team of people, you have to go out campaigning, you have to go knocking on doors, delivering leaflets. You've got to tell everybody your message and try and win them over. Some seats, they might say, is more predisposed to being of a certain political persuasion, but I've also stood in a seat which is known as a tight marginal seat, and it changes in different elections, and that's really difficult, and that takes a lot of campaigning, because you can switch or change the dial in those seats. But that was me there. I think that would have been in about 2017 when I won the seat in Tatton.
So there's a lot of very important roles in the UK government, which Esther's had, but Esther's also had a career on TV and media, and I've added in a special summary of who Esther is, an all-round nice person who I'm really proud to call one of my friends. Okay, so Esther's going to tell us more about her career, the roles, what she's done in government, and the important lessons she's learned. And I want you guys to all think of questions you can ask. You can put your hands up and ask as we go, or you can ask at the end. So Esther, over to you. Tell us about your life. Is this a picture of you as a little girl, is it?
It certainly is. I'm 2 and a half there, but I think what's most alarming, you could probably tell that was me, can't you? I don't really think I've changed too much at all. I was quite mischievous, and I'm in the back garden there, and I think I've just been told off. I didn't have any shoes on, and I was running outside, so that was me. But I always say to people in life, it doesn't matter where you come from, it's where you're going to. My parents were very young when they had me and didn't have much money and needed some help and support. So I ended up being in care. I was a Bernardo's child for the first few years of my life. But my mum and dad worked really hard. My dad set up a little business. They got some money. They got themselves, I don't know, sorted. And then they got me back. I always say, because people will say, well, what was that like to be in care? The odds are I didn't really remember it, but I know those people who must have looked after me, must have cherished me and loved me. And then I think it's really special that my parents fought really hard to get me back. And then I went back to live with them. But isn't it good that we have charities and we have people who are happy to stand in and care for people when they fall on hard times? Probably one of the reasons I wanted to go into politics, because I think everybody does deserve a second chance. And I do believe as a society, we should help people when they need it.
Amazing. Okay, so getting this is you getting a bit more grown up then.
It certainly is. So you're right. I studied the sciences at A level, but I went off to university and studied law. I was always interested in science and how things worked. I was good at maths and science, but one of my best friends was brilliant at maths and science, and she went off to work on the genome project. And I think in life, you have to know what you're good at, what you're very good at, and what you're really interested in, because if you're going to spend your whole life doing something, you've got to be really interested in something. So I, like I said, I like sciences. I was going to do engineering, but I was more interested in how people worked than objects worked. And then I thought law was for me, and I'd always been interested in law. It was the teachers trying to talk me round to do the science subjects rather than law. I used to watch Rumpole of the Bailey, I used to watch Crown Court, lots of TV shows, and used to visualize me being a lawyer and helping people. So that's why I studied law. And whilst I was at university, whilst I was studying law, to give myself some money, because I was at university in London's an expensive place, I worked in a restaurant in Covent Garden to get myself extra money. And that's where I mixed with lots of people I would never have mixed with before. People who were working in TV, in media, people who were lawyers, people who were writing plays, you name it. And I thought, wow, I could always go back to law. I'm going to get my qualifications for law. But do you know what? I'd like to try and work in TV, because that sounded so enticing and so different, and nothing anybody I knew had done. So I wanted to give it a whirl. And then my dad set me a year as a time frame. He says, you've got a year to get this job. If not, you better go back and do something that you can do. So I set myself a year and I got a job within that year.
Amazing. We've got some questions. Ibrima, have you got a question?
It's more of a statement.
Okay, go on then, Ibrima.
I researched Esther and it said she was on Great Britain News.
Oh, yeah, that's part of the stuff Esther's been doing more recently is GB News. And well done, Ibrima, for doing the research. That's fantastic. So Esther, that career in the BBC from back then led to you being able to do things like GB News more recently.
I think what's important now, whatever you do, you're always going to have to communicate your message. And that is true of politics as well. So what are you doing? Why are you doing it? Or why aren't you doing this is part of your job. And so I can't now do the show on GB News because I've gone back into government. I'm in cabinet, so I cannot do that extra job. But you'll often see me popping up on various channels as I explain what the government's position is, why we're doing things and how we intend to implement them and how that's going to help the country. So communications, whatever your job, is very important.
Noah, what's your question?
When you completed the degree in law, did you find it hard or was it like easy?
If you want to get the best out of things, I guess they're always going to be hard. You could read a book quickly and get through it, and you've read that book. But if somebody was going to ask you questions on it, you might not remember everything about it, or maybe not go into as much detail on maybe what the characters are about or how intense the story was. But if you study it harder and harder, you get to know things better and have a greater knowledge of that subject. So I will say, the more you study, then it will be tougher and it will be harder, but you'll get a lot more out of it. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So I'd say, do it as hard as you can, study as hard as you can, and you are going to reap more rewards than doing it quickly and easily.
Amazing. We'll come back to questions. So as we've seen, Esther's done a lot of different things, but they're all linked and all of them have fed in and led to what Esther does now. So Esther, you then started getting experience in business. Now, all the kids here are very interested in business and some of them are already running businesses. If we take, where's Toby? Oh, there he is. We take Toby, who you can see on the screen. Toby's running a business and has made nearly £2,000 selling sweets and he's 11 years old. A lot of the girls have sold bracelets. So tell us why you wanted to start a business.
I think you've got to have an idea that you believe is marketable, sellable, other people will want to do it. So I think you've got to have the product that you think is worthwhile selling. I also think it takes a certain personality that wants to be in charge of their business, their work, their day-to-day existence. So I think it's a combination of factors. I also think you've probably got to be quite comfortable taking risks. I think you've got to be very comfortable at selling what you do. So it does mean you've got to be a bit of a risk taker and probably have a lot of confidence in yourself and what you do. So I think for all those reasons, I wanted to set up my own business rather than be employed by somebody else. I've done both and I've enjoyed both, but there is something quite special about being in charge of your own destiny. And if you set up a business, you are certainly in charge of your own destiny. And you're also responsible for everything.
We've got some questions. Katie, what's your question?
Did you like going on Great Britain News?
Yes, I did. I enjoyed it. It was a brand new startup TV station, which means that it's quick, it's nimble, it takes chances, it gives people opportunities. And it was just wanted to be very different. And it also wanted to be the station of free speech, lots of opinions, and open to discussion on most topics. It was challenging the older TV channels, which it thought was rather staid and predictable, and this one would be slightly more irreverent and new.
Fantastic. Okay, so Esther, tell us about If Chloe Can, because this is work you've done with children, isn't it?
It is indeed. So I set up a charity called If Chloe Can, and it's all about career guidance. The picture you're looking at there, I've got some here. We did a load of different magazines highlighting different people's jobs, careers, how they got them, how hard they had to try to get them. And that picture you're looking at there is, it was also made into a theatre production with the National Youth Theatre. So we travel the country taking this play to different pupils right across the country. But it was really about exciting people about job opportunities and the whole array of careers there are on offer.
And now, If Chloe Can is still working, isn't it? We're working with teenage girls.
It is indeed. And I think you say that it is about confidence, assertiveness, resilience. It's about finding something you'd like to do. It's about working out your personality traits. What would I like to do? Is that the sort of job I could excel in and I'd really want to do? And then going through all the options. So we do quite a few workshops, but it's as much about a pupil discovering themselves and being honest with themselves. So discovering what you're about and then looking at all of the jobs and opportunities out there and then matchmaking you with the jobs. And then I always say, do work experience, do Saturday jobs, sample all of these and see which one really is for you.
Amazing. So all along, because I know lots of you, we ask about how things are going to change as you get older. So all along, Esther was doing politics, she was doing media, she was doing charity work. And in the background, Esther was starting to build her political career. So Esther, let's talk about time, because these things don't happen overnight, do they?
No, they certainly don't. And I remember all of my general election campaigns. Some I've won, some I've lost. And you've got to keep going. So it took me 10 years to win my first election, which meant I lost one before that. But I never like to see it. I don't look at it that you lost something. I say I came second. And in politics, if you come second, it means you lose. But failure isn't losing. Failure to me is giving up. And I didn't give up. I didn't win the first time I stood, which was 2005. But you know what? I learned a lot from it. And that was in one of those seats which can shift from election to election. So I had to work harder when I was asked that question before about, is it easy? Is it hard? The harder it is, the more you do, the more success you can get. And this was in 2010 when I actually won, having spent 10 years fighting for that seat in Wirral West, galvanising a team to come out and help me, selling the message on the ground, helping people in the local communities, getting involved with all local interest groups and winning battles on their behalf. So that's what I did. And that was when I first won.
I think we've got some questions. Mila S, can we see if your audio is working? What's your question? Mila sometimes has audio issues. Let's see, Mila, try and talk.
What age did you start working?
Oh, very good question. My dad had a little business, so I was working in my dad's office. He might have said I was more of a hindrance than a help when I first started, but I was probably about 14 when I first started doing stuff for him. When I was younger than that, I used to go with him to work and probably just sat and watched in the car. But when I first got a wage, because this sounds really mean, but my dad never paid me. When I was working for him. But when I went to university and I worked as a waitress to supplement my income at the age of 18, that's when I got cash. Before that, my dad just provided me with pocket money.
Oh, I love that. I love that. Stella, what's your question?
Did you ever think that you wanted to do something else, or that like you really wanted to do something different?
Do you know what? I think we all dream about things we'd love to do and maybe achieve. And there are things that you can do day to day, and there are things that you think, I know I could do that. My mum does it, or my dad does it, or I know friends who can do it. But you can dream about something. And I guess, first of all, I dreamt about law, but it was there was a path that you could definitely follow. You could definitely get these qualifications. You could definitely go to university. It was a very simple path. You had to work hard, but it was a simple process to follow. Going into TV was one I probably dreamt about, and I didn't know if that was going to happen. So what I did there was take any opportunities. Now you can go online and Google, where should I send my CV? Where should I work? Who should I try and do work experience with? So keep those dreams and keep going for them, and then do everything logically along the way. Get your exams, do your Saturday jobs, take any other job, because I always think it's easier to get a job from a job. Don't ever think a job is beneath you. You're always learning, and whatever you get from your startup jobs, whether it's working with people, taking advice, being on time, being part of the team, shorthand and typing, IT skills, whatever it is, keep going. Always hold that dream and that thought, but just keep taking baby steps along the way.
Amazing. Now, I know there's some more hands up, but let's go to our next slide first. Esther, you were the first person to win this seat, and it had taken you 10 years. Just explain to people, explain to the Biz Kids what that means in terms of why hadn't the Conservative government won a seat in your area before for so long?
Okay. So first of all, we hadn't been in power. We'd been out of power since 1997. So the Labour Party won in 1997, and Merseyside is traditionally a Labour area. Liverpool is
where Merseyside is. Who's from Liverpool? Do we have anyone who's from Liverpool? I think Evie's from. No, do you all know where Liverpool is? Yes. Okay. The school geography is working good.
So Liverpool is an absolute centre of socialism and Labour. But Merseyside, there are a couple of seats that you might possibly win in a good year. But so I went back home to Liverpool. I thought I wanted to represent people. I knew an area I knew, somewhere I absolutely loved. And I thought, but what is a possible seat that I could win around there? And that was a seat called Wirral West. Now, I always say ignorance is bliss. You must go on a journey. You don't always know where it's going to go. If I'd have known on day one I wasn't going to win this seat for 10 years, I might not have gone on that journey. I didn't know. So I'm always full of expectation and full of hope. So I lost in 2005. Devastating, but I carried on, and then I won in 2010. Now, I don't know how old you are, some of you here, but I bet you 10 years is a lot of your life. So to think, however old you are, that I took most of maybe your life to try and win a seat and become an MP in an area, it's quite a long time, isn't it? Most people give up. Most people might give over a year, they might give over 2 years, but 10 years is a lot of your life. So you've got to enjoy it.
Noah, what's your question?
I have actually two questions. Well, one is a question. One of them is just a statement.
Go on then.
The question is, did you ever have a pet?
Did I ever have a
pet?
Yes, I did, but not well, only when I was at school. I had a dog, a beagle called Biggles. And then I had two other little puppies that were abandoned on one of my dad's building sites. And one day he went to work and he was checking the building site, and in a little sack that was wriggling around, and in it were two little dogs, two little mongrels, which I called Racker and Becky. So I had three dogs growing up. But as an adult, I haven't, because I live in two different places. I live in Westminster part of the week and I live in Tatton, Cheshire the rest of the week. So it would be really cruel. I couldn't look after it, but I did as a child.
Noah, what's your other question or your statement?
Was my mum's a lawyer.
Oh.
Yeah, you said in the chat your mum's a very good lawyer, isn't she?
But she works on a particular thing. She works on to help businesses. I don't know what lawyer that's called.
Contract commercial?
Lawyer. Yeah.
Yes.
That's impressive, because I would have stayed as a lawyer. I think it's a fabulous profession, but I also think it's a fabulous qualification to have as well, because you can understand the law, you can try and negotiate, mediate for people, or you can try and fight their battles and win their arguments. I think it's a fabulous profession. Is your mum great? Is she good?
She's really good, but I also want to become a lawyer, but I want to become a divorce lawyer because I like hearing about drama.
Oh,
it's fun.
Noah has a very clear idea of what she likes and what she doesn't like and what she's good at and what she's not good at.
Certainly picking one side or another there, trying to win one side or the other there. Oh, I can't wait to see you as a divorce lawyer in whatever 20 years' time. You'll be formidable.
Ibrima, what's your question?
Have you met Afzal Khan yet?
Have you met Afzal Khan?
Yes.
Who's Afzal Khan?
He's a member of parliament and a Labour Party politician.
Oh, Esther, might be someone you know. Do you know him?
I can't say I know him. You don't know all 650 people in the House, but there's lots of them who I do know. Why do you know him?
Yes.
And go on, what's he like?
He's pretty tall from the pictures, but he's a nice guy.
Have you got any gossip on him? Have you got anything I should say hello to him for you?
That you should choose my painting to send around the country.
You should choose your what, Abrima?
Painting to send around the country.
Your painting, Esther might be able to get that message through.
Yes.
So that's one of the really important things we've heard, is that when chasing your dreams, sometimes these things take time. We have some of you who are 10 years old. Who's 10? Put your hand up if you're 10. We've got some hands going up. So for your whole life, Esther was working just to get started in politics. Okay, so the question of what is failure? Esther, just give us your view on failure.
I think failure is giving up. I think failure is putting aside your dreams, your aspirations, because you think maybe things have got a little bit too tough. And I think what you've got to do is give things another go. Now, things, you might need to do a little bit more research, and you might need to check that you've got all of the credentials for that dream, whatever you have, but don't give up. Keep chipping away and keep aiming in that direction of that goal, you know, that dream, that hope that you want. Now, that does not mean you might not change your course slightly along the way, because you will learn about things. You go, do you know what? I don't want to be, I don't know, a rocket. I'll give you an example. You might not think, because the lady who I know who's an engineer at Google, she always thought she wanted to be a brain surgeon. And she thought, that's what I want to do. Then she realized she wasn't buried with blood and gore. And she thought, oh, I can't do this. I'm too squeamish. But she was still fascinated by the brain and how the brain worked. So although she didn't become a brain surgeon, she ended up being one of the top engineers for Google. And that was mapping how the brain worked, how Google search worked. So in the end, although she changed her path from one thing to another, it stayed within that spectrum of what she wanted to do. Like I say, don't give up on your dream. Keep going for it. You might slightly adjust what you do, but you're going to get there. Does that make sense?
That makes perfect sense. Marnie, what's your question? Marnie, just unmute yourself. Go ahead.
Do you know how it took you 10 years to get a spot? How come you decided to keep on going and you just give up?
I think a couple of things. One, I was very close. I was nearly there. I felt it was within grasp what I wanted to do. And then what I thought is, do you know what? I started on this journey knowing nothing. So I was a real novice as I start off. But 5 years in, I thought, I've learned a lot. I've got a lot more connections. I can do the job quicker than I could before. I've learned quite a bit. And I really do believe I can switch the dial to win over 1,000 more extra people to vote for me. So I guess there was personal belief. And I'd learnt a lot, and I was prepared to put in that extra time to carry on and win a seat and become a Member of Parliament.
Brilliant. Olivia, what's your question?
Why did you decide to become a Member of Parliament?
Oh, that's a good one. I'll tell you why. I think there's a couple of things that might happen in your life. And something might move you so much that you think, oh, this is the job I want to do. So I've spoken to people who said my mum and dad or my sister or brother was really ill when I was growing up. And I always felt that when I was an adult, I'd like to be a doctor, because I'd like to be able to help people to get well, because I lived with this all my life. So they were really moved to do something. I guess I went on a journey, and bit by bit, I thought, I'm good at solving problems. I'd like to help other people. I think I've got the ability to read the law, change the law, because I understood that through the studying that I'd done at university. So I was driven by wanting to help other people and solve problems. And I think my early childhood of being in care, I always believed in opportunities for all, and people given the right conditions can succeed. And I do believe that human nature is fundamentally good. And I think people are fundamentally good and want to help other people. So there were quite a few parts, but that's why I was driven to help others and become an MP.
Fantastic. So Esther, your role today, her official title is a cabinet minister without portfolio, but the role is known as the Minister for Common Sense. This means Esther works across all these different areas: treasury, which is money, housing, communities, and local government. Now, we've got a question for you. What is common sense? Mm-hmm. Who knows what common sense is? Annie, what's common sense? You just have your hand up?
No.
No, okay. Who's got Noah, what's common sense?
When basically you're like very smart, but you don't know everything, you just know the basics.
Noah, that's kind of part of it. Faith, what's common sense?
We're like, it's like things that you probably, that probably most people will know in like their snappy thing, but if someone were to ask you that, you would probably know the answer.
So you're saying it's the things that most people believe, Faith? Is that what you're saying? Where's Faith gone? Oh, did we just, is that what you're saying? Okay, great answer. Sarah, what's common sense?
Common sense is when you go into the shoes of the other and you're feeling like what they are feeling in the same time.
Great answer. Toby, what's common sense? Toby, you're muting yourself? Yeah, what is it, Toby? Oh, I think Toby, we've got Wi-Fi issues. Stella, what's common sense?
Something that's almost quite obvious that we don't really talk about, because it's just like something that would be like your parents are older than you or something, like something that's quite obvious and that someone already knows, so you don't really talk about it because it's just something that everyone knows.
Great answer. So Esther, do you want to talk to us about common sense in terms of your role and this title for you?
Okay, I think those were great answers there. So I see common sense, or it's been defined as the very basic ability to perceive, understand and judge things in a practical way from past experience and accumulative knowledge. And it involves logic, reasoning and objectivity. Aristotle said, considered common sense as one of the five senses. That's how important it was. Descartes saw it as a reliable source of knowledge, which complements reason. And John Locke considered it a basic and fundamental capacity of human understanding. And then the bit I think is funny, Voltaire said, there's nothing common really about common sense. So we know what it is, but it's not always as common as that. So I think all of this is like accumulated sort of knowledge and reasoning. And everybody touched on a little bit of that. Oh, it would be so obvious, or your parents would be older than you, or this. So that's what I say. It's logical, it's reasoned, it's basic information. It is all of those things. And people will also say you can't spend what you haven't got. So they talk about finances. You've got to work hard and deliver your job. You've got to make sure it's value for money. All of these things people would say is common sense.
Fantastic. So has the government got common sense? Who should we ask first, Esther or the kids? Let's ask the Biz Kids. Katie, who wants to answer that? Who thinks the government has got common sense or hasn't got common sense? Any break? Katie, what's your thoughts?
I think we do, but I don't know why.
Okay. Great answer. Marnie, what's your thoughts? Marnie, just unmute yourself.
Rishi Sunak was talking to the press and he said that children come out of school without the basic numeracy and literacy needed to fulfill their potential. But I feel like when we go to school, like half of it is learning and you don't really get that much break. So I don't really agree that maybe some people in the government have common sense, but not like everyone.
Okay, Noah, what do you think?
I
If I'm being honest, no, because like sometimes they talk about things that don't actually need to be talked about. Like, for example, like some people do have it, like some people have common sense, but some people have no idea what they're talking about. I'm going to be honest. I might be one of those people though, so.
Great answer. So Esther, in your role today as Minister for Common Sense, tell the kids what you have to do to ensure to help with common sense overall.
Mm-hmm. I think it's been a very difficult time post-lockdown. And I think coming out of lockdown is going to take a huge effort to get everything back on track, because basically the world stopped for 2 years. So I think there has been an element of hope over reality. So when you talk about, oh, does everybody have common sense? When people keep coming to government and MPs saying, we want more and more, whether it's more money, more support, more whatever, you've got to say, but hang on a sec. Can the country, because it's not the government, it's taxpayers, it's coming from the public's purse strings, can they afford it? Is this a genuine offer we can give, and is it deliverable? And now we're doing that on lots and lots of areas. I think the other thing people will say, we've got to get to net zero, and then people will question, yes, but in what time frame is that possible? They'll say, have you got the infrastructure? Have you got the scientific technology? So I frequently think when things get derailed and they're not following common sense, it's because there's too much hope over reality. There's too much wanting, but not actually being realistic enough, both in the time frame and cost. And government has to look at everything in the round. What's possible, which is what is the art of the possible, and what can we afford? Now, did that make sense, everybody?
Who can think of something they really want, but they might not have the resources, time to get it? Who's got something they really want? Noah, what do you really want?
I really want another dog, but I don't have the time to do everything I need to do. Also, can I share something at the end?
Yes, you can, Noah. You absolutely can. Katie, can you think of an example of something you really want but don't have the resources for?
I really want another sibling because I really like helping my mum with babies, but my mum won't, so.
That's a great example.
So there's things there, isn't it? And it's not just about money on those, whether it's a dog, a pet, a person or what have you. It's the time, it's the support, it's the nurturing. So there's so much that goes into that that you've got to consider. And remember, it's not just for a day or a week or a month. It's for a lifetime that you've got to do that. And that's why I say you can't sometimes have hope over reality. You can't do something in a whim because it's going to last a heck of a long time.
Exactly. Okay, so Esther, what are you most proud of having done so far in your current role as Minister for Common Sense?
In the current role, so you mentioned before across the different departments I work with, so it is working with those teams to look at new solutions coming forward. So some of them were changing to, which was a train line, which was never going to work. It had gone from 37 billion to nearly 200 billion. That money could be spent doing something better for more people, like local transport. So it's looking at something, seeing, does it work? Who's getting the benefit? Actually, could we change that into something better? And the big job I'm on at the moment is working with all of the arm's length bodies to see, are we getting value for money, and are the public getting a good customer service? So this is a big job of work I'm on at the moment to make sure taxpayers get value for money and get to the service that they would expect. And as I said, all of things slightly went awry during lockdown. So I'm helping get out of lockdown and get everything back on track.
Amazing. So we can ask Esther some questions on anything that you want to ask somebody from the government, a cabinet minister, about, including these topics, which are work, the environment, the country, education, or anything you're worried about. So if you've got a question that you want to ask the government, now's the time to ask the question. Katie, what's your question?
I'm not worried about anything, but have you ever went to a different country to do your job?
I have indeed. I've been a part of those big meetings, the G20, so 20 different governments joining together to come up with maybe a vision, a mission that they'd all share. And I was a minister for employment at the time, and that we all agreed on was supporting more women into work. So we came to a collective agreement. So yes, and I was in Australia to do that.
That's so amazing.
Annie, what's your question?
I have two questions.
Okay.
Who's your favourite person in the government?
Oh, are you going to give me two questions so I can think about who's my favourite one?
And the second question is, who's the most famous person that you've met in your job?
Okay. So I'll start with the most famous person. The most famous person, or when I speak to people, they think she was the most famous person on the planet, and that was the Queen. So I've met the Queen and the King, but most people say, absolutely. I can mention other people to them, but the Queen is absolutely the most famous person. So when you become Secretary of State, she gives you your crest, as it were. So she made a Secretary of State. And prior to that, when I was made a Privy Councillor, I became the Honourable Esther McVeigh. She did the ceremony for that. And I'd seen her at other things too. So do you think the Queen is a pretty famous person?
Yes.
And
yes.
You met the Queen multiple times, Esther. Very
And cool. Multiple times, yeah. And the King. And I've met Wills and Harry as well. President Barack Obama. So lots of people thought he was up there too as well. And my favourite person in government. There's quite a few, actually. I do a lot of work with Johnny Mercer. He's in my department and he's the Veterans Minister. I do a lot with Alex Chalk, who's Justice. And I've known for a very long time the Chancellor, Jeremy Hunt. And whilst I haven't known Rishi, that's the Prime Minister, really for that long, I've known the others longer. Actually, the more I know him, and I think this is very telling about an individual, the more I know him, the more I like him. And he's a deep personality with more qualities to him. So actually, if I put them all up there, I would actually put Rishi Sunak as number one.
Wow. Great question. Olivia, what's your question?
What's the hardest thing you've ever faced as a member of parliament?
Everybody will say, I off the top of my head, standing at the dispatch box to do question times, your questions for your department, where you can have potentially up to 650 people ask you a question, is probably the toughest thing you can do, because you've got to think on your feet and it's a hostile environment as people are trying to trip you up. So I think that has to be one of the most difficult things is being on peak form and being asked any question.
Esther, don't you have to do that a lot, though? Isn't that a regular occurrence?
So you'll do it on a monthly basis, but it could be more. So basically, say people are questioning something you've done, they will demand you come to the floor of the House and answer something known as an urgent question. So you could be in the news, something's happened, something's just broken, breaking news, and they'll call you to the floor of the House. And that is difficult. And I used to, when I was in the Department of Work and Pensions, I frequently had urgent questions or oral statements. And of course, the Prime Minister has to do it every week. A PMQs. If you're in a department, you're let off. It's not as frequent as that.
Esther, there's a question coming in from people on the TikTok live stream. Who's going to win the election and when is it?
I don't know when the election is. I remember the Prime Minister, if you recall, said it would be no doubt the second half of this year. So he's got until early next year, but I'm going along with that. But as you can imagine, you'll roughly have in your head where you think it's going to be, but things could happen both on a local, national and global scale. So you might tweak that. But I'm going for second half of this year. And of course, I want the Conservative Party to win. Now, if you look at the polls, it's not looking good for the Conservative Party at the moment. We're not in the lead. But I do believe with the work we're doing and what we know we can do to turn the country around, I believe we've got it in us to win.
Amazing. Evie's just arrived back from the hairdressers with a brand new haircut.
Oh, let's have a look.
She's in the car. Evie, have you got your hand up to us? She's got a fringe and looks transformed and a blow dry.
Wow.
Evie, you've got your hand up to ask a question. You're just listening in.
Oh, I'm listening in.
Okay. Let's just do these last few questions. Katie, what's your question?
Your job is, are you like running for the, I don't know what it's called, like president for the UK?
No. So in the UK, it'd be the prime minister. So I'm not running for the prime minister. We've got a prime minister. But what I am is part of his team and his team in cabinet. So I'm working with him to support him. And as Natasha said before, I don't have a portfolio, which means I have a roving brief and I help the various secretaries of state. So I'm there to support.
Do you like working with him?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. It's a very intense job. You've got to be happy to get up early in the morning and stay till late at night. Tonight, we could be voting at 10 p.m. And if we vote at 10 p.m., depending on how many votes you've got, you could be out 11 o'clock or what have you. And I'll be back tomorrow morning. I do cabinet on a Tuesday morning. So I'll be up at about 6:30 and I'll be at cabinet tomorrow about 9 a.m. And then we vote tomorrow at about 7 o'clock, 7 p.m. So it's a mixed day and I'm in Westminster Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, go back to Tatton for surgeries of a Friday and Saturday and campaigning. So it's a busy week.
Okay, fantastic. Noah, what's your question?
I was just wondering if I can now say my
thing. Yeah, we will in a minute, Noah, when we wrap up the lesson. Right, another lesson from TikTok. Another question from TikTok. How do we get Biz Kids on the national curriculum, Esther? What do we do?
I think you're doing this after school. And remember, if you put something new on the curriculum, it means you've got to take something off the curriculum. Now, we don't want to take anything off the curriculum, but what we'd like to see is this as an addition. Would people be happy if it was of a lunchtime? You'd have all of your other, your maths and your English and your science and your languages, you do all that. And this is like the icing on the cake. Because it's fun, it's informative, it's practical, it allows you to explore what you want to do. So I'd be saying lunchtime. What do you think?
Guys, what do you think? Biz Kids at lunchtime in your school. Evie definitely wants Biz Kids in her school. She's always asking.
Yeah, like I even made a presentation why we should have it in our school.
Did you, Evie? That's so sweet.
Yeah, last
few questions, then we have to let Esther go because she is running, she is in the government, probably has some important actions to do. Last few questions. Olivia, what's your last question?
Was it hard to become a Member of Parliament?
Yes, it was. But I'd say everything you want to do is going to be tough. What would you like to do? What would you like to do as a career? Do you know?
I think I just want to become an entrepreneur.
An entrepreneur, trust me, that is going to be difficult. To be a successful entrepreneur, it is going to be difficult. But if you want to be the best you can possibly be, it's going to be difficult. You guys putting in all this extra time to do this Biz Kids, I believe you're the people who are going to do incredibly well at entrepreneurs, in business, whatever, in politics, in medicine, in science, whatever it is, you're going to do well.
And also, Esther, can I just give a shout out to these kids because they all bring themselves along every single week and the people on our live stream. They come along every single week, which is incredible. But all of them choosing to come themselves. I don't think people are being sent by their parents, choosing to come by themselves.
So that drive, that motivation, that natural curiosity is what's going to drive you all your life. You're going to put in that little bit extra. You're going to learn that little bit extra. You're going to have a few more friends. You're going to have a few more opportunities. And this Biz Kids, you're getting those opportunities here and now.
Okay, so before we wrap up and let Esther go, because I'm very mindful of time, Esther, these are some questions that you said to me you always ask yourself when you're thinking about decisions, which I think were really great. I'll run through them and then you let us know why they matter so much. So Esther said she asks herself, what can I do well? What can't I do well? What can I get better at? And what do I enjoy? Esther, why are those important questions to ask yourself?
And you can ask these at any age. And you've got to be honest with yourself. What am I good at? And you might say, I'm good at science, or I'm good at maths. I'm good at solving problems. I get on with people. I'm a great orator. I'm great at sport, at dance, whatever it is. What am I good at? Then what am I not so good at? Be honest. Are you a quiet, diligent person who likes to study and be with books? Or are you somebody who's gregarious, outgoing, needs to be with people? So what is it you're good at? What can you get better at? What was I not so good at? What do I need to learn from? Maybe you've got a quick temper. Maybe you're a bit grumpy. Maybe you should smile a bit more. Maybe you should be kinder, more considerate. Whatever it is, have something that you think, you know what, today I'm going to get a little bit better at this. I'm going to learn a little bit more about that. Maybe it's just you were mean to somebody, and you know what, you just need to apologize. You just need to say, do you know what, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to be mean. And then you've got that friend back. And then what do I enjoy? And then what do I enjoy? If you find out what you enjoy, do you know what? Life is going to be just one great breeze. Of course, life's difficult. You have tough days. Things will go wrong. People will fall out with you. People will break your heart. All of these things happen in life. But if you're enjoying what you do day to day, you're just going to have a much better, happier existence, and find good friends, because you've got to share that joy or share that pain with good friends, and they will make life so much easier for you. So get some good friends.
Okay, and we've got some, before we wrap up, we've got a few more questions, but we'll try and get through them pretty fast, Esther. If you need to go, just say. But Esther gave me some great wisdom. Wisdom number one, Esther, don't weaken yourself by being a victim. Tell us more.
Yes, don't ever say, don't empower somebody else by making yourself a victim. You are in charge of who you are, and you must empower yourself, not weaken yourself. And don't look to somebody else to solve your problems. You might need help. They might need to give you a bit of advice, but you need to be responsible for your actions. Take charge, and you are in charge of your life, not anybody else.
Amazing. Number two, Esther, the importance of working hard and persistence.
It's totally got to work hard. We've had this a couple of times now. Was that job hard? Was it easy? Do you know what? If it's hard, it means you're doing a better job. If you're doing a better job, you deserve all the success you get. Persistence pays off.
Fantastic. And point number three, be optimistic and kind.
Yes.
Esther, you've met a lot of people in your career. Why is this so important?
Be optimistic, because I think if you're optimistic, you've got more energy, you're hopeful, and people want to be around you. I do believe, I've said this earlier, humans are kind. Remember that. Most people are good people and kind.
And finally, don't be worried about changing paths, because we've seen Esther's had a career where she's been in television, business, and now politics. And she's done all three of them at the same time at various points as well.
Yeah, so go along a journey in life, carry on, and you will refine your skills and knowledge. You will get opportunities along the way, and it might take you down a different path, but know what is your core ingredients. Mine's problem solving. It is law. It is communication and caring about people. I learned that about myself, and politics was for me.
Fantastic. Okay, so we'll let Esther jump off. Esther, what do you think about the chances of the Biz Kids doing a tour of Parliament one day in the corridors?
I'd totally do that. I would arrange that for you, and I would meet you here if that's what you want to do. Because I think you're all special.
I want a tour of Parliament, guys. Let's see. There you are. Look, you've got... Who wants to go to the power... The House of Commons, and see where Esther works and where all this amazing decision-making takes place.
100%.
Yeah, 100%.
Well, let Esther look, she has to get back to her job. But Esther, thank you so much. And guys, we can stay on and you can share your updates, Noah, and everything. Esther, thank you so much for joining us today.
Not
if you
at
want
all.
To talk after, I will message you afterwards.
About the tour. Let's do it.
Let's do the tour. Everyone say thank you and bye to Esther.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, Esther.